Welcome to this follow-up conversation with my sector lead, Adgild Hop, for retail. We will talk about, again, the future of consumer industry and the research that we have been doing over the past 2 years and will be continued to do. Buying into Better is a more specific title around that. And we will zoom in on a couple of topics that we think is going to be important and have implications on the markets, the models, and the mechanics of retail businesses. Adgild. Super to see you again. I recall our conversation on the couch, and I'd like to pick up where we left last time. Two things. So, how do you see the influence of the changing demographics? So, talk about age, the declining birth rates, the aging population, the disparity of wealth to the elderly versus the younger generations. On one side, and the other side, the societal impact. So, how do people identify the influence of immigration? In short, a changing consumer person, I would say. And if you look at the research in the markets model for who is my consumer and what do I sell to the consumer, we have concluded that it's no longer, as it has been in the past, a mass distribution, a mass production, and a mass marketing. It is now going to be from mass to micro. So micro specification, optionality, and those kind of things. So I'd like to get your views and reflections on how you see that. And after that, I'd like to pick up again on the conversation we had if you would be a CEO for 6 months. But let's start with the first question.
Okay. So let's start with the easier of the two questions, and which is the shift from mass to micro. For someone like me who's been in retail for almost 20 years, I still found the results from this research really, really insightful and quite surprising. And on reflection, I talk a lot about retail and you know that in essence, retail is simple in its core, right? You buy something, you move it to a collection of shelves, and then you sell it, and that's your model. And that pretty much means that you kind of the economic value add isn't that high, and hence the margin isn't that high, and hence the only way to make significant money from retail is if you do a lot of those movements. And so if you go to mass, if you simplify the model and you assume that most of your consumers or all of your consumers are the same. And if you look at retail, let's say from the 50s onwards, the assumption, largely speaking, was always that our end consumer in most cases was, you know, a white family with 2.4 children and a station wagon and a white picket fence. And that was the model, and hence kind of building a retail model around that kind of made sense, and it worked. But what this research clearly shows is that that assumption is now just intrinsically flawed.
Yeah.
And it's becoming flawed, but it's becoming flawed quite quickly. You mentioned significant age disparity, rising age rates, really significant polarization between the haves and the have-nots, really yeah. big polarization politically as well.
And a big generational wealth disparity. Yeah, so the research shows that the wealth will be with the elderly at the moment. So the boomer, so to say, and the Gen Z is really lacking behind.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that specific point is something that not enough organizations have properly cottoned onto. Most of what we get excited about tends to be trying to seduce, you know, younger consumers, whereas increasingly the money sits with the elderly. So I think that's a really good example of this shift. Migration patterns and the changing construct of what our society looks like is also clearly a big shift. So our society as a whole is becoming significantly less homogeneous than it was. If you then look at how consumers identify themselves and how they want to live their lives, that's also just massively shifting.
Yeah, and what do you think is the biggest challenge from that micro perspective for retail? Because then there might be more than three choices for a certain product, maybe 20 or 11. So how is it going to work? How is it going to be profitable?
So I think this is one of the key questions, where there are so many now, in essence, micro segments of consumers that you can't imagine that you can run for example, a grocery proposition or a furniture proposition, which pleases everybody, which means that you need to strike this balance between, A, I think, trying to make choices about which subsegments you go after and by default, which subsegments you don't. In addition to that, probably the proposition, as much as possible, does need to get more segmented than it currently is. The challenge is that the more that you segment the retail proposition, the more you need to segment the retail business model, and the more your profitability just becomes really difficult / impossible.
Yeah, and I can imagine that platformization has. So you sit behind your platform, you order the products that you look for and that you like most, and you design them towards your own demand, that you maybe even can surpass the retailer and just get it drop shipped from the one producing it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think as we shift to more micro, it becomes more important that you understand your consumer, which by default is a consumer data game, and which is where I think we're only starting to see this now. But you know, the data gets generated through engagement and through interactions, and part of that is the retail transaction. Clearly, that happens in the channel, but most of the consumer data that we generate happens within our digital lives. For example, on social media, and you're right. I think one of the big shifts that we're going to start seeing is social media shifting into social commerce.
Yeah.
And that, again, poses some really big questions about where, as a consumer, I spend my money and whether, in fact, I'm spending my money in retail or whether I'm spending it somewhere else.
Yeah. And can you talk a little bit about social commerce and how you see that evolve?
So my sense is that, you know, if I look at, I'm sometimes a little bit ashamed to say, but if you look at my life and how I spend my time on my sofa, but certainly, you know, how my wife does it, but my children as well, a large proportion of our waking life is spent on social media, be that TikTok, Insta, Facebook, you name it. Their current business model is mainly founded on selling advertising space to companies trying to sell me something. And that's a really viable business model, clearly, which has changed society. But what you see them experimenting with is taking what they know about me and not just selling advertising space, but selling the ability to sell stuff to me. And so I don't think it's going to take long before, for example, on Insta or on Facebook, it becomes really easy for me to immediately buy what I get inspired about on that social media channel without ever leaving that social media channel and going to a retail channel. And that has, again, profound potential implications for retail.
Yeah, and I mean, we need more time to have that conversation. I can imagine also that, and we know from research also that the trust is an important factor. The loyalty is the big challenge. So the opportunity sits in staying close to your customer, have that customer loyalty, get that equity, that customer equity out. And what are the ways to do that, and how do you improve that model? But that's a challenge. So let's have that conversation at the next time. I'd like to go to the second question, Adgild. So you spoke about 6 months ago, I would, as a CEO, focus on profitability of my business, which models, etc., and make sure that we make an affordable business. What do you see at this moment, 6 months later? We promised to get back and get the question. You get an extension for another 6 months as CEO. What is it that you would change or maybe continue?
So I'm not just saying this. I think being a retail CEO in today's world is an incredibly hard job. And so if someone had made me retail CEO 6 months ago, I'm not sure I would still have that job. By now, because it is a very, very, very challenging job. But assuming I was given an extension of my tenure, and assuming I was able to convince my stakeholders and my shareholders that the day-to-day management of a profitable retail business now I could delegate to my leadership team, then I do think the big strategic themes that I tried to explain 6 months ago remain, which is number one, this concept of buying and selling a jar of peanut butter and that being my business model with which I derive profit, I remain convinced that for a lot of retail, that's a really difficult future model. And so I have to go and continue to go looking for other ways to make money. That's data monetization, media monetization, asset monetization. You know, do I become a company that offers sourcing services or logistics services, et cetera. So I would keep laser focused on answering that question 5, 6, 7 years from now.
Yeah.
And in addition to that, I think the other thing that I mentioned last time is that to make that shift, one of the key enablers to that is leadership and culture. So I hope that in those 6 months, I would have made some progress on leadership and culture, but it would remain a strong focus moving forward.
Super, super. So I'm curious to see how that evolves again. And again, back to customer loyalty, I think that is one of the topics that is definitely high on your agenda as well, to make sure that you get a connection and stay connected with that customer. Thank you, Adgild. It was good to have the follow-up conversation. Looking forward to another 6 months period and see how you have done as CEO and whether you get another extension. It's a very brief period, six months by 6 months, but I think that's in line with the market at the moment.
Indeed. My pleasure.
Thank you. You.